हरि
ओम शन्नो मित्रस्यं वरुणः शन्नो भवत्पर्यमा शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः शन्नो विष्णुरुक्रमः नमो ब्रह्मणे नमस्ते वायो त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि त्वामेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि ऋतं वदिष्यामि सत्यं वदिष्यामि तन्मामवतु तद्भक्तारमवतु अवतु माम् अवतु भक्तारम् ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
I thank you all for the happy presents you have given me today. I thank my host who has created this opportunity, also the opportunity to make a contact with the organization of the International Planetary Synthesis. Today's subject to speak is the Deva Kingdom and the cooperation of the human beings with the Deva Kingdom. The word Deva may be new to some people, a word from the Sanskrit scriptures which has the same meaning as the angels and the archangels in the holy scripture of the Bible. But the two terms are not generally understood by either the Orients or the Occidentals of the 20th century. When an Occidental Christian reads the Holy Bible and understands and notices the existence of the angels and archangels, he takes them as the description of poetic imagination, or that such things as angels would have existed in the past. And more than that, he never pays much attention. Same is the case with an average Indian of the 20th century. When he reads the holy scriptures of India and finds the name Deva in it, many Devas are described in the Indian scriptures. We find a classification of the Devas into many groups. Some people believed that it was an ancient belief, and that the people of the ancient days believed in such beings. But at the same time, there are some people who know the truth of it. There are some people who know the truth of it. Just as there are people who know the real meaning of the Holy Bible, which is different from the Christian way of understanding it, so also there are great people in India who know the real meaning of the Indian scriptures different from the Hindu way understanding them. They know the truths of the scriptures of all the races, and they know that the scriptures do not belong to any religion. They were books of the wisdom of the ages, and after the age of religions has come, and after the understanding of mankind, is narrowed down into the belief of one religion or other, into the belief of, then these scriptures were not properly understood. Even then, the masters of wisdom understood them and preserved the real significance of these scriptures by handing down the wisdom from generation to generation. But they could transmit to those who are ready, and the others normally do not receive it, because it requires some advanced evolution to receive the real significance of the scriptures. In the end of the 19th century, these masters once again transmitted the same wisdom to those few people who could receive, especially one lady from Russia who went round the world many times. She came across these people who knew the secret of the scriptures, and they have given her the required training, and they have explained her the real meaning and significance of the scriptures. They also induced her to write big volumes about the significance of the scriptures, and the volume is called The Secret Doctrine, which was completed by the beginning of this century. It is such a treasure house of scientific wisdom that it has influenced the minds of the foremost scientific thinkers of this century. What we see as the modern scientific thought of today is only a germination of the seeds that are there in the great book, The Secret Doctrine. The wisdom of the Devas is also explained there for the first time, and afterwards people began to know of it once again. A second time, the same thing is explained in more detail by the same masters to another lady by name Alice A. Bailey. Through the works of these two disciples of the masters, we now get a fairly good idea of what the Devas are. Now, those who can read the Indian scriptures can understand about the Devas better, and those who read the Bible can understand the angels and the archangels better. But it took some time for the facts to be received by people. Afterwards, there are students who could understand the existence of the Devas. Now, let us try to know who are the Devas or the angels. If we begin to study nature in its true sense, then we will be able to understand the existence of those peculiar beings. In fact, we can ourselves understand without the scriptures that the Devas exist in nature. But to know more about the Devas, we have to read the works of Blavatsky and Alice A. Bailey properly. And in the light of those explanations, we have to read the scriptures to know better. When you observe the behavior of a magnet and the scientific law of the magnet and its properties in the books of science, you will understand that much of the properties of the magnets are known to the human beings. But when you begin to question why the magnet behaves like that, there must be an answer. If you put this question to a professor of magnetism, why the magnet shows north and south. Why the magnet shows north and south, and why unlike poles of a magnet attract each other, why the like poles of two magnets repel each other. The professor of science answers you, but it is the properties of the magnet. He gives you an answer which you already know. You know those properties. You ask him why they behave like that. He gives you the same answer, that it is the, they are the properties of magnets. That is why even the professor of science could not understand why the magnets behave like that. Not that it is difficult to understand, but that he does not care to understand, because he does not care to put this question to himself. Unless we have eyes to see and ears to hear, we cannot know the truth. That is what Christ said. When we read this sentence, we wonder, we have eyes, we are seeing, we have ears, we are hearing. Why Christ says like that? But we do not know that we are blind though our eyes are open, and we are deaf though our ears are working. The questioning is not there in us, and the good sense to care to know things is not there in us. We have only curiosity but no good sense. Good sense means honoring the law of everything in nature. Curiosity means trying to know something just for the fun. Since we lack in the first, we are blind though our eyes are open. Since we are not having the first item, we are blind though our eyes are open. That is what Christ warned us. That is what all the masters warned us. Now, once again you put the question, why the magnets behave like that? Is it conscious that they behave like that? Is there any awakening in the magnets? Is there any intelligence in the magnets that is making them behave like that? At first, we deny that there is intelligence in the magnets. This is because our education teaches us that intelligence belongs to the human being only. So this orthodoxy prevents us to think further. This aristocracy in which we are trained prevents us to think further. It blocks our intelligence. But when we observe that there is a procedure in the behavior of the magnets which is always consistent, and with every magnet the same procedure is found, then you will understand that there is an intelligence working in the magnet. With great difficulty, we accept it that it is intelligence, because we have to sacrifice our vanity to accept it. Another example. Take the seed of any plant. When you sow these seeds in good soil, the seeds begin to germinate, but they give the same tree. The seed gives the same tree. You cannot get another seed if you sow one. If you cannot another tree when you sow a seed. If you sow a banyan seed, you cannot get a rose tree. Every seed gives only its own tree. Why? You question it once again. Is there an intelligence in the seed which remembers its own tree and recollects to give the same tree? Is it an intelligent process or not? To remember the tree, the seed should have some intelligence. You have to accept it. What is that intelligence that is working in the seed? When you understand the development of the embryo, you will find only 32 teeth developing. 32 teeth developing. And is there anyone who knows counting in the embryo? I think the communication is not either my pronunciation is difficult or her understanding of my language is difficult, something is wrong. Wish if Marcel can give an example of doing it today so that tomorrow she may continue it, because you are accustomed there.
Yes.
But today you just observe the terminology I use in this sentence. Is there anyone to count numbers in the embryo, but how the embryo can produce only 32 teeth? The answer should be yes, there is an intelligence to count in the embryo. Otherwise, there is no possibility. All these answers give us a clue that there are intelligences working in nature. There are intelligences which can count, which can produce things according to number, shape, color, and smell. See how the banyan seed produces a tree which smells once again like a banyan tree. All these things introduce a new dimension of science into us. That is the science of some intelligences working in nature. Sugar is sweet, salt is saline. There cannot be a mistake. And how this consistency is maintained? The salt should have a presiding intelligence to produce saline taste to your tongue. The sugar should have an intelligence which is presiding, which makes the sugar taste sweet to your tongue. The consistency of the behavior of matter, the consistency of the behavior of force, and the behavior of the atoms of any substance, different from the atoms of another substance, clearly proves the existence of certain intelligences existing everywhere in nature. Common sense makes you understand that these intelligences exist in the atom, in the counterparts of the atom, in the seed, in the biological cell, in the minerals of the earth, in the gases of the air, and in the water, and also in the rays of the sun from above downwards. Water flows. You cannot see water flowing up against the gravity unless you make it flow. When you make a flame of fire, it travels away from gravity. You cannot make the flame flow towards gravity unless you create some conditions. So there are intelligences which manipulate the flame. There are intelligences which manipulate the water. The properties of liquids, the properties of fire, the properties of gas, the properties of light and sound, all these prove us that the whole universe in which we live is full of millions and millions of intelligences that are always at work. If you observe a child breathing, inhaling oxygen and exhaling carbon dioxide without studying chemistry and not knowing what oxygen is and not knowing what carbon dioxide is, you have to accept that there are intelligences inside who know oxygen and who know carbon dioxide, and there are some more intelligences who control oxygen and carbon dioxide to make the respiration properly. If you begin to observe like this, you will clearly understand that from your foot to your head, every part is governed by millions and millions of intelligence. Now, until now, the scientist has not recognized any one of these intelligences. He is busy with his observations and results, tabulating tables, forming tables of the results. It is like a mathematician residing in the next room, staying in the next room, solving big mathematical problems on a paper.
Sur un papier.
People in this room receiving only the answers. So the answers can never be solutions. The solution exists with the person who solves, and the process of solving is what is called science. So there is another dimension which is to be opened to the modern scientist. Then only the present problems in the modern science will be solved. Now, having coming to understand that there are these intelligences, now we should find their name in the scripture, because we don't find their names in the modern science. They are called devas, angels, archangels. They are described as glorifying the Lord before his altar. And glorifying the Lord. They speak of the glory of the Lord. That means these intelligences prove the existence of the one Lord. When you study the various planets and their workings, and when you study the solar system, also yourself and your relation with the solar system, if you study from this point of view, at every step making a nice questioning, and then wait until you receive the answer of the intelligences, then you will understand the existence of the angels and archangels. This is by way of introduction. The ancient most scriptures, which we call the Vedas, they say that the human being has three obligations on this earth. They are called the three debts of the human being.
Debt,
money borrowed. When he is born, he is born with these three debts. The one is his obligation to the devas. The second is his obligation to a second group of specific devas who are called the Pitrus. And then a third group of specific devas who are called the Rishis or the seers. We have three obligations. And before we die, we are expected to fulfill these three obligations. Just as the great obligation described by Pythagoras. Pythagoras also gives us one obligation and one fulfillment.
Accomplishment.
He says, before you die, you have to reduce the number of fools in this world by one. So you make the number of fools less, one less, and that is yourself. A second obligation Pythagoras prescribes is, you should increase the number of wise men by one. That is yourself.
C'est-à-dire vous-même.
Whether you do other things, you achieve other things or not, you do this. That is what Pythagoras says. Whether you achieve the other great things or not, you do this before you die. Similarly, the ancient scriptures of India describe your obligation to the devas, your obligation to the Pitrus, your obligation to the Rishis. The first obligation is to a group of angels called devas, who preside over the air, the fire, the earth, and the space and water. You have to accomplish your obligation to these devas by keeping your environment clean and holy. By making the air around you clean and not foul, by keeping the water you use clean and not to pollute it, by keeping your room clean without making it a pollution. This is how you have to fulfill your obligation to the deva, so that other people may not feel a nuisance of your existence.